What's going on, YouTube Gardener? It's your boy Sydney from the Naked Gardener channel, and today's video we're going to do a video of a garden tour of my friend Peter. Peter, kind of tell us about your channel and what got your name of your channel and what all your channel is all about.
Well, basically I call it Birth of a Garden because I wanted to create a garden, and gardens represent, you know, kind of something biblical in a way. And I wanted to, it was something brand new into the world for me.
Yeah.
And so I wanted to create something new. I called it Birth of a Garden because it's a new garden, and it was centered around and very inspired by my neighbor too, to be honest.
Okay.
And that's Miss Tate, and I was thinking, why should I not do it myself?
Mm-hmm.
You know, this is a brand new thing for me. It's a scary thing, like any birth will be. You know, I mean, it can be painful, it can be discouraging, but you persevere and you learn to grow, you know, and that pun is intended, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you really want this to grow. And I wanted to be self-sufficient. I didn't want to get my food from the,
from the grocery store, yeah.
You know, I wanted to make sure I was growing my own food. I know where it's coming from. It also gave me the opportunity to start my own business.
Okay.
And I thought, why shouldn't I do this? I know I've done this since I was a boy. You know, I was taught to do this. You take all your talents, master those talents, and create a business.
Okay.
And if you do what you love.
Yeah. And what's the name of your channel?
Triumph by Will. Now, this is tricky.
How did you come up with that name?
Okay, because I believe in that sense of perseverance. I mean, when you triumph by the will you have in your heart, you're just going to succeed. You know, no matter, it's one of those phrases I heard from a group called Huey Lewis and the News. You remember that group?
The pop culture of the 80s.
Oh, yeah. Well, they said it took them 12 years to be an overnight success.
Oh, wow.
Literally, it happened in 24 hours after 12 years of persistence. And that's one of those things. And that sense of regret, you know, to say, I could have done this,
mm-hmm.
you know, to wake up one day and you're 60 or 70 years old and you look back and go, because hindsight's 20/20, why didn't I do it?
Yeah.
You know, and I'm seeing all these individuals, you know, and of course, it makes my mom proud.
Oh, that's good.
Because, you know, that's what she did, you know.
So. And where are you originally from? We hear the accent.
Here's
and everything.
The thing. My dad was in the British Royal Navy, okay? And so when he was out of the Navy, he came over here to the U.S., got under contract with the U.S. government.
Mm-hmm.
My eldest brother and my sister were already born in the U.K., okay?
Okay.
But my twin brother and I, my mom became pregnant.
Twin brothers?
I have a twin.
Okay.
Yeah, we're 5 minutes apart. Yeah.
Who's the oldest?
He is.
Okay.
By five minutes. And so we were, you know, conceived here in the U.S. So
okay.
I got dual citizenship. And that's why. And then we moved back when he ended contract, because he renewed the contract. And so we went to school here in the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
And then right around 14, 15 years of age, we moved back.
Okay.
And that's where I pretty much grew up, which is in the London area.
Okay.
Like that. And so my father's originally from Liverpool. Okay. But my mom's from Barbados.
Okay. So you got the England and the Barbados colliding together.
All exactly, right. Yeah. And there's English settlements over there. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah,
so,
yeah.
Know, French settlements over there and whatnot. So,
mm-hmm.
And she's from St. Michael. And a lot of people, St. Michael, they go, where are we honest? That's right. The only way people are going to understand.
Oh, like, oh, okay.
Do you know Rihanna? I'm like, no, I don't know Rihanna.
Yeah.
Like, well, how would I know Rihanna?
Exactly. You know? So tell us about your concept, where you got what's all out here right now.
Well, this basically is prepping for fall.
Mm-hmm.
You know, now, what I'm going to do here is that you've got these three liter patches right here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Basically, 3 gallons maybe. And the idea is to go ahead and get those all along here during the winter. And then I've got the fencing, and what I'll do is I create its own little fenced-in area inside the pot.
Okay.
This will prevent the volunteer four-legged creatures from having a blast with them. But it'll make it easier for me to move them around. And the idea is to create a black flower is just going along.
Okay.
Here. And then ground cover is going to be thrown in here. So I've got peas that I'm going to be planting in here for the winter. And I've got a ground covered flower that blooms during the winter as well, during the fall winter. So that's going to cover all along here. And the idea is to get flowers all along the paths, the border of them.
Okay.
Like that. And I left this in here just for water drainage, you know, and that's the original ground, if you will, or the original lawn.
Okay.
Right here. This is where
right there.
Are,
so all of this you've been built up?
I built right up.
Oh, wow.
And this is after 2.5-3 years of it. Yeah, because I started this in 2017. And, yeah.
Oh, you
and
got
you
the
have
cardboard
no.
There.
Oh, yeah. And what's great is if you go a little deeper in here, now, a lot of people sometimes dig deep in there.
Mm-hmm.
And what they'll come across is, oh, those are spider webs. And that's mycorrhiza.
No, yeah.
Yeah.
That's
a good sign, because you should see what happens sometimes, like especially during the spring. you'll have mushrooms popping up everywhere.
The sign of good, healthy soil.
Totally, and I'm doing the right thing, so I know I'm doing it all correctly.
Oh.
And so you come across this section of where it all began. Because the first thing I did, even before putting down cardboard or anything, was start a compost.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's one of the easiest things you can start with when you're starting your own garden. You know?
Oh, yeah.
And then, so this is the second, I should say, but probably like the fifth time I built this up. Now this, guys, is about 10 days old now. And it's ready to be rotated again. This was up to here 10 days ago.
Mm-hmm.
That's how quick.
Oh yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and yeah. We got a pile. We just made it out of pallets. And I just rotate it. Once the temperature gets below like 110, I'll have to flip and rotate it to the other side. Put the whatever's on the top, put it down at the bottom, and vice versa. Keep on wetting it down and stuff. Now, something that you do, I don't do is I don't cover my compost area.
Okay.
And it was only for the reason because when I was watching somebody because they were saying compost need what? Air.
Air.
And water.
And water, exactly, yeah.
So when you cover it, you suffocate in it. And so I was like, okay, so I'd never done it. But I see a lot of people do it.
It's halfway true.
Yeah, I see a lot of people do it, and it whatever works,
well,
it works.
The reason why you want to cover it, and the reason why I do it, is because there's a myth saying that you can't compost meats.
Yeah, you can.
You can compost anything organic,
because
nature does it already.
Oh, exactly.
So there's no reason why you should not compost those bones, considering they have calcium, magnesium in them, and you want those to break down.
Look at the Indians. They used to bury fish.
All the time.
Yeah.
And it works.
Yeah.
Trust me.
Oh, yeah.
So basically, I'll cover this too, because there will be animals that will, you know, they want to dig in there and get in there. And then sometimes, you know, like if you've got neighborhood cats or if you've got possums, they want to make biological deposits, if you will.
Yeah.
And so we don't want that in
there,
you know, because you actually can compost cat waste.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You want to, and that's another section I'll show you right over there, what I did. And it's to keep it you keep it away from all the other actual food you're going to grow. A good distance away. You can keep it a good, 30, you know, meters away, 60, 70 feet. And then you're good to go.
Mm-hmm.
And you do the cold compost on it. This right here is fresh. And what I did over here, before adding new organic material, we'll uncover this. And I just kept this covered. Now this, actually, there may be creepy crawlies in there, but if you go in there, this is actually ready to be taken, put into the wheelie bin right there, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then sifted.
Yeah.
And you can smell, it's starting to smell like soil.
Yeah.
You know, especially the deeper you go, right in here. And there's no other organic material in there.
Now, this grass is, and what you get in
this
here.
Is dried grass clippings. And these were heated up to a very high degree. I mean, this got really hot, like 54 Celsius. I mean, that's really hot. You couldn't put your hand in there without a glove.
Mm-hmm.
And what that does, it will destroy any of those rogue
germs,
seeds.
Weed seeds, all of that, yeah.
Potential, maybe something that shouldn't have gotten in there, you know, it'll completely cook it off. And then it will break down once it starts getting to the active stage.
Correct.
And cools down a little bit, and then it starts breaking down even further. So I kept this covered up, keep the critters off of it, and protect it. So when I'm ready to rotate, because I put some in there, when I'm ready to sift it out, I'll take these large pieces and these leaves, and I place it at the bottom. So it creates kind of like air underneath there as well.
Yeah.
You know? And it creates proper drainage. Because you still want it wet, but you don't want it soaking.
You don't want it like sopping, sopping this, saturated
with it. Aerobic or something?
Yes.
Yeah.
And you want it aerobic, not anaerobic.
Anaerobic.
When you get it anaerobic, that means you need to add more carbon in there to help
precisely.
That carbon eat that on that nitrogen and stuff like that.
Yeah, and then you get that sweet smell, you know. And then I'm experimenting with a whole bunch of different ways of creating compost to grow particular vegetables, like I get access to a great deal of sugary items.
Yeah.
You know, pastries and whatnot.
Oh, really?
So exactly. So what I'll do is I'll go, and I'll go ahead and I'll create a pastry compost with lots of carbon, pastry products, rotate it, let it break down. You need a lot more carbon than norm.
Mm-hmm.
But what'll happen is you'll create this soil and it'll smell like soil, but kind of a sweet smell.
Mm-hmm.
And I use it to grow tomatoes.
Mm. Okay.
And then all of a sudden, what's in that compost goes into your food.
Yeah.
And then you got these sweet, tasty tomatoes.
You know, so what'd you call that over there?
This would be your general produce section.
Okay,
produce. So you grow your greens, your squash, your zucchini, things like that. I would do rather well with the winter squash and summer squash.
Mm-hmm.
But I had to get some weight because I just had so much of it. And I didn't plan ahead and find recipes to go, you know, cook it up. So I gave a lot of it away. And then this along here was growing a bunch of melons. There were so many sweet melons that I had. I had to give those away. And this is one of my pride and joys right there. Oh, watch your step, please. My apologies.
That's all right.
This is ready to be harvested.
Yeah.
And it is, it just, it blew up all by itself. I was like, I've watered this maybe twice.
Mm-hmm.
And left it alone.
And the one thing I noticed about Swiss chard is it's most forgiving. Like it's, we had one that almost lasted about like a year and a half. Mm-hmm. We didn't, from the fall, winter, spring, it just stayed like this. All we did is eat or cut just whatever cut, we needed. It never bolted or anything. I just got to a while, I was like, okay, I got to pull it up. What was your biggest produce that you
was stay successful on?
Yeah.
This puppy right here, this was one of the first successes, and it was this bed.
Uh-huh.
And this bed's been aged for a good 12 months now, and I wouldn't call it a raised bed per se, because the idea of how I got these beds set up is by another gentleman. Now, he's native to England, and it's Charles Dowdy.
Yes.
Okay. I'm huge on his technique on how he does his beds.
No-till, just basically keep on adding on there.
Because nature doesn't do that.
Yes.
You know, and you destroy so much.
Mm-hmm.
You can't believe the damage you're just creating.
Mm-hmm.
We have thousands of years of soil, rich soil, that was destroyed in 50 years in just a fraction of a time.
Mm-hmm.
Destroyed in 50 years from tilling.
Yeah.
You know, and of course you put all the pesticides on it. And I'm like, why are you doing this? Just follow what nature has given it to you for free.
Mm-hmm.
And she's telling you, here you go, do the same thing I'm doing.
Yeah.
And so the idea is, I just bordered it off.
So you just use reclaimed wood?
Reclaimed wood, anything. It's one of those phrases I heard from a kid. He basically said, it was on one of the channels I constantly watch and dealing with gardening and whatnot, was if you don't have what you need, use what you have.
Yeah.
And I decided to get a lot of this I found along the neighborhoods here, along the urban neighborhoods here, where people are putting the debris
mm-hmm.
on the
on the side of the road, yeah.
Exactly,
which is bulk pitcher.
Things like that, that bed, where they do things like that. And I guess the lorry comes by,
mm-hmm.
the garbage truck.
Yeah, mm-hmm. the bulk trash.
And they
trash,
do it only like once a month or twice a month or something like that?
Well, ours, they do it
every Friday.
Every Friday.
Is it every Friday?
Yeah, for in us. Our area, yeah.
I heard they only do it twice a month here, and I'm like, I'm not like, oh, you know, like an elitist, but the idea of seeing all that just sitting there for weeks on end, put it to use.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't go to landfill.
Yeah.
So I decided that I go around and I don't have to worry about my overhead.
Yeah.
Since, you know, while I'm making this happen, a lot of my materials are free. I would say a good 85 to 90% of my materials I get are completely free. Yep.
I want you to show us the mattress or the spring bed.
Yeah. This is another pride I love, guys. I'm serious.
Because it was very ingenuitive.
Yeah, right here. And this comes right on through right here. And then what I did is I was going to do the same technique that Charles Downing did.
Mm-hmm.
And I did begin it, but I had this and I was like, I do not want to get this to landfill. And I want to grow a complete bed of food for just donation. For those who really need some healthy food.
Because
I don't know if you've been to some of the charitable, we call it shelters.
Yeah.
But I understand that people can't grow their own food, so they bring a lot of canned food. And for me, that's just a coffin for vegetables.
Yeah,
that's all it is.
A lot of processed food,
sodium content, and it's ridiculous. It's just a coffin. Now, if it's the apocalypse, you've got, you know, zombies, I get it. Don't let it be your first resort at all. And I'm going to tell you right now, proper food grown, it does something to you. It helps you out. It helps you sleep. It helps you think. It helps you concentrate.
Mm-hmm.
You know, your central nervous system is not out of whack.
Yeah.
You know?
It's medicine.
It's complete medicine.
Yeah.
Because this
food
is a
machine. Be your medicine.
So what I did is I took a box spring and I thought, okay, wait a minute, fabric containers, this is fabric. This will
mm-hmm.
breathe, so I don't have to worry about it not breathing.
Mm-hmm.
And because I didn't want to do a raised bed. And so I thought I could use this and still do a raised bed, but still have that sense of that nature coming through. But way before I even put this down, I had a beautiful same dimensions as you see here that I was using on my compost, and I made a beautiful bed. And then what I did is I put this on top of that.
Okay.
So if you were to remove this right now, the soil in it there, you could probably buy a brand new vehicle by selling it. It's really healthy, seriously. Because underneath, it's heavy. Take a look right there.
Oh yeah.
All that is just.
Can you get that?
Yeah.
All underneath there. And you can't imagine the life that's going on underneath it right now. And what's great about this is that underneath this box spring, all it is cardboard.
Mm-hmm.
So that breaks down naturally.
Yeah, the worms just eat on that and then
right,
whatever.
And then they come right up in through mm-hmm. here. And this is just, I mean, you pulled it off the side. I don't think we want to get a shot of this, but here's signs of your mycorrhizal growing
mm-hmm.
right here, right there.
What was that? Show that to me.
Your mycorrhizal, the fungi that you want. All right here, that. It looks like cobwebs from spiders, but.
You got some nice soil, right?
Look, you're telling me. And I'm just,
dark.
Oh my God, it's just like, look at that. Do you see, I created this.
Yeah.
This was this was not from a nursery or a big box store. And you probably know how much this costs.
Oh yeah, that's why we do our own.
I did my numbers on this. This would have set me back about $400 in garden soil,
mm-hmm.
just this bed alone. And I was like, how does that add up so quickly? And I was like, that's a lot of money. You know?
Guys,
like,
you guys would totally just geek out all night.
I'm a nerd.
About soil.
I can go on
when
forever,
it comes to soil.
People are like, Peter, stop talking.
No, it's like his first love, the soil.
And it's just, oh God, I love it.
Yeah, I love the color of it and everything. Yeah, everything is broken down
and
on
there. And I would love to give you a shot of the aged soil right here and all that. Mm-hmm. And all I do is put some vermiculite in there and
mm-hmm.
some
mm-hmm.
Perlite. Mm-hmm. You know, which is the volcanic rock.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And those have, they're porous.
Mm-hmm.
So that holds that fungi in there too. And it also lets the air through. I started to overwinter these, trimmed them down. And I don't know if this is, but Callie Kim,
mm-hmm.
you know,
uh-huh.
what,
yeah.
29, yeah. Callie Kim, she's the one that showed me how to do this.
Yeah.
And so I do my best.
We just recently
it's supposed to release in the morning, but we're doing something else.
Okay.
The overwintering.
So we just
video.
recently did ours because we had a lot of prolific peppers that we want to keep. We're trying to kind of get a jump start for next year. That's all in containers. So we did the same thing, chopped it down. We did added some fertilizer, put some mulch on it.
That's exactly what I did.
And now we're just waiting because what peppers did we did? Cayenne, the poblanos. Jalapenos. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, these are the poblanos, right?
Yeah.
We did the
did some Jimmy Nardellos.
Yeah. And
these the crown.
Were over this. It was crazy.
We did the bishop crown.
These are your habaneros.
Okay.
And I got these seeds. They were organic seeds, so that really helps. They were very viable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so they really just flourished. I had so many.
Now, interested in this, you just basically made your own greenhouse.
Well, this basically is a you know, pastry canopy.
Yeah.
You know, that's all it is. And I did it to protect it from the rascals, because they'll get in this and lay in it because it's comfortable,
mm-hmm.
and they'll crush this. Now this is kohlrabi.
Okay,
I sowed some kohlrabi, and it actually will do well over the winter. You can start in the spring as
mm-hmm.
well, but the first time I ever grew it was during the fall winter, and it did rather well. And then again, we're in this area of the world,
mm-hmm.
so it's much easier to grow something like that during the winter. I've been here in Texas now going on since 2013.
Okay.
And it was 2013, so I've been here for a minute. And so the winters here get cold from what I experienced in January and February.
Mm-hmm.
It's the coldest you guys get.
Yeah.
You know, because you
and
guys.
And it's about like 40, 30 degrees
right,
at the cold.
And rare.
The first winter, there was ice.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was ice. You know, I'm back home.
Well, Peter, thank you for showing us a good tour of your lovely garden here and stuff like that. Hopefully we can come back during the springtime once you got everything flourishing out and kind of showing us around. Once again, you want to tell everybody your channel?
Yes, it's basically Triumph by Will. Now, it's going to be a 3, and then the first letter is the capital U, and then you just spell it out. All together, Triumph by Will.
We'll put your channel link down below. Go check his channel out and check out some of his videos. They're interesting videos and stuff like that.
Comment down below that you want to see his face in more of his videos.
Yes, because he never shows his face.
And he has a lovely face.
You got to show them the face with the accent.
It took me a while to actually even start talking.
Yeah, I remember.
I was like, don't.
I didn't
know what to say.
Yeah.
I was like, just do a silent thing.
Yeah, so when you first started, you had your phone, vertical and stuff like that.
Yes.
And you would just show it, and I'm like, hey, man, talk. And then turn your phone to the side so you can get the...
He He's the second guy that you've told that to.
I watch a lot of your videos.
Yeah.
I watch a lot of your videos. I'm serious. I'm constantly watching your videos.
Yeah.
It pops up. I'm like, what you got?
Yeah.
What you
got? We're always looking for ways to improve our videos and showing different ways of showing our garden and stuff like that. So just keep on at it. You're doing a good job. I appreciate
having you guys here, truly. Again, you know, those who do subscribe, just comment below. I'm down for any constructive criticism.
Oh, yeah.
Totally down for it. I'm like just absorbing as much knowledge as humanly possible.
All right. So we'll put the links of his channel so you can go check his videos out. Give him a comment. Make sure you give him a like. And if you like his channel, make sure you subscribe to his channel and hit that bell icon so you don't miss the upload. And so until the next video, let's grow together.